become acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Please be seated. Good morning. Thanks to Mary Kirkpatrick, I came across a prayer that I'd like to begin my sermon with this morning that has to do with living in that relationship between those of us who are here physically on earth and those of us who perhaps have died. It is appropriate to pray this prayer in light of the fact that we celebrate All Saints' Day today. O God, come now and live in us. Let us stay in you, since if we be all in you, we cannot be far from one another, though some may be in heaven and some upon earth. Amen. There is something about All Saints' Day that has taken a long time for the Christian church to get a hold of, and yet I think has been present in all of humanity from generation to generation now for thousands of years. And that is that urge, that desire in all of us, both going back thousands of years into the present day, and I'm sure encompassing future generations for thousands of years as well, to be connected. To be connected to one another. It is not enough, as John Donne, that Anglican clergyman, wrote so well years ago, to be an island unto oneself. We're not human when that happens. When we close ourselves off to others and refuse to be connected, then we become less than human. The very definition of what it means to be a human being means that we're connected to others, whether they be our immediate family, whether they be our immediate friends, or whether they be to people halfway across the globe. We have a drive, an innate, insatiable drive, if we want to be human, to be connected to one another. That's what holds out the promise, you see, for things like email, or Facebook, or whatever the next version of all of that technologically connectedness is about. It's a manifestation in our own way, in our own day and age, of that insatiable need to continue to be connected. The church recognized that. The church recognized that connectedness here on the face of the earth as being undeniable as a way of defining humanity. That's why weekly worship is so important. That's why prayer is so important. Praying for those of our family, our parish community, praying for those concerns that we have worldwide is an expression in the church of our connectedness one to another. We become inhuman when we become disconnected. Whether it be in church or outside of church, we have no option as human beings, but if we want to live and live fully, to recognize the fact that we're connected one to another. That's why that passage, that sentence in our baptismal creed, our baptismal ceremony, is so important. Do you remember the sentence that in which the celebrant at a baptism says, "Will you respect the dignity of every human being?" Every human being. That's the most powerful sentence I know of in the baptismal service. Because what it gets at is not just respecting the dignity of your spouse, not just respecting the dignity of your family, not just respecting the dignity of those in your parish community, not just respecting the dignity of those who might be Americans, but in a global sense, respecting the dignity of every human being who is walking on the face of the earth. In every country, in every land, in every culture, in every religion, it doesn't qualify who a human being is. It says there is full status given to every human being, and because everyone is made in the image and likeness of God, then therefore they are of innate worth and have a respect that as Christians we have to honor because they have dignity as a human being. That's at the very heart, not only of Christianity, but it's at the very heart of Western civilization, perhaps the survival of the world as we become a global village. It's no longer an option not to respect, or at least strive to respect the dignity of every human being. That's the challenge of life, and it's the promise of life in the 21st century. Not only for us at St. Matthias, but throughout the globe. Respect the dignity of every human being is something that you and I will be challenged with for the rest of our lives here on earth, and our children and grandchildren will be even more, I think, challenged by what the implications of all of that are. It's an exciting and challenging and probably somewhat frustrating time in which to live because of that. That's the interconnectedness you see of all of us on this planet Earth. And the church goes even beyond just saying that we're interconnected while we're on the face of the earth. The thing about All Saints Day is that the church has maintained that there is this kind of mystical communion, this way of relating to one another that engages not just the living to the living, but the living to the dead as well. And that somehow or another, because our souls are immortal, we're connected not only to those of us who are still alive, but to those of us who have preceded us in death. And that there's this almost thin veil that happens between the living and the dead. You know, most of us grow up thinking that when you die and go to heaven, what you'll find is that heaven is some kind of a place way out there beyond the stars. I don't think that's true at all as I get older. I think instead, where heaven is to be found is very thin place between us, the living, and those who have died. That's why we tend to dream about people that we've known and who are now dead. They're still alive in that sense. They're still part of what the church calls the communion of saints, the living and the dead. And I know a lot of people in society will poo-poo that notion and say, well, you can't prove it. But you can prove it because you're constantly reliving and recreating your relationship with those not only who are living, but for those who are dead. If you don't understand that, you don't understand why it's so important to have some kind of closure and resolution with parents, for example, or with siblings, or with troubling people in your lives, because that relationship is still alive, and until it's resolved in some way, you're not going to experience peace, and it's going to keep on getting in your face about dealing with it. That's why the communion of saints is such an important notion, and it's not to be poo-pooed at all. It's to be made alive and vital, so that we become alive and vital. You see, the church is standing up for something that I believe is basic to being a human being, which is not only that we're connected to the people here on the face of the earth, but we're connected to all of creation. And will be connected after we die. My own theory, take it for what it's worth, is that Albert Einstein and the people who developed quantum physics did us a great favor by kind of coming up with a mathematical formulation of where time and space interact. They come and become one. It's at 186,000 miles per second. The speed of light. We haven't attained that yet. It's just a theory, but it's a reputable theory. And at the speed of light, the theory is that time stands still. And I believe in the theological language, that's what Paul was getting about at in the 13th chapter of his letter to the Corinthians, his first letter to the Corinthians, when he said, now we see in a glass dimly, but then face to face. And so what happens after death is that somehow or another, our souls, our spirits, speed up to this 186,000 miles per second, and we see God face to face, and our lives take on a new meaning, a new understanding of what's really important. And it's not washing dishes. It's being connected one to another. That's the promise of the church. That's why we are here, to get a glimpse of that, even if it's in a small way, on days like All Saints Sunday, to be connected. Those of you that have lost spouses, or even worse, perhaps, lost children, know exactly what I'm talking about. In order to live, in order to make sense of your life here on earth, you have to come to grips with the fact that your spouse is not really totally dead, but alive. And you can connect with that person. There. So this is All Saints Day, a day when we remember those who have gone before as being still with us in some way. I want to read the names of those people that we have before us who have preceded us in death this past year. We do this at All Saints Sunday every year at St. Matthias and every Episcopal church I know of and every church in the Anglican Communion. These people are listed, I believe, on page 6 in the bulletin, if you'd like to follow along with me. The prayer for All Saints Day reads as follows. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints and all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. To Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God, in glory everlasting. These are the people I'd like to read. There are more. We have been blessed, I must say, at St. Matthias, with not having an awful lot of funerals of parishioners this year, but we certainly have extended loved ones who have died. And so today, let us remember in our prayers Dottie Bruner and Carolyn Ayers and Melvin Harris, the uncle of Carolyn Ayers, Dr. William Holland, Helen Stringer, John McVicker, Steve Wilson, brother of John Wilson, Mary Ellen Hammer, the mother of Elias Slack, Russ Palmore and Paige Harmon, friends of Marilyn Kirkpatrick, and Eugene Liberati, the grandfather of Lisa Rose. In addition to those people, please keep in your prayers the souls of Carol Hendricks Davidson and Della Moosley, who are friends or perhaps relatives of Janet Perkins. And just before the service began, I was asked to keep in our prayers the soul of Louise Porter, who is a member of the Swenson family. This is not a complete list of those who have died or extended family members who have died this past year. So you are free to add your own at this point. Are there any people whose souls for whom you would like us to offer in prayer? Go ahead and speak that out.
Kathy. Aaron Warren.
Susan.
Thank you.
the spirits of those whom we have mentioned are with us. Allow us to experience a connection through Jesus Christ to them and to the nobility in their lives, so that we ourselves may experience life in its fullness. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, if we stand and say the Nicene Creed together.